this is Cable Street Mill, Wolverhampton. I started working here in November 1975 until it closed in July 1996. I filmed this during the 90-day closure notice. I was a mill crane driver and I did some of the filming from the crane. There was two mill teams working on a day's and night shift rota, and this is the shift I worked with. Was the roller, seen checking the bar, and David Bailey was assistant roller. Roy Good worked the guide rolls, and is standing this side of the rolls, making adjustments. Temperatures would get very hot when the mill was rolling at full production on the night shift, and even hotter on the day shift, with temperatures well over 100 degrees. Once the bar has been checked and passed by Steve the roller, more billets are discharged from the furnace, and the mill can begin to roll the bars. Customers was Garrington's in Darlaston and various other companies in the Black Country and nationally. Depending on the order schedule, the mill could roll flat, square or round bars of various sizes, from 3/4 inch to 3.5 inch. Today they have set up the mill to roll round bars. Stuck and adjustments are made to get the bar through the roll. The shift manager is Phil Jones, wearing the white hat. Steve the roller is exempt from wearing a hard hat because he has to regularly check the size of the bar. The bar is stuck in the automatic bar turner, which is being adjusted to release the bar. If the bar goes too cold, Steve would reject it, and it would be dragged off the mill for scrap. Unfortunately, it has gone through the rolls. A major upgrade in the summer of 1987 with the addition of the reversing rolls and the vertical rolls, where the bar can be seen passing through. Through the finishing rolls onto the cooling bed to gradually cool down, ready to be cut to different lengths by the shears. The length of the roll bar depended on the diameter or thickness of the bar, and the thinner bars would cover the length of the cooling bed. Colin Jones, who worked the shears, and Rainer, the QC inspector, wearing the white gown. Stock pens are almost empty because of the pending closure, but when the mill was in full production, it averaged 1,000 tons a week, and the pens would have been fully stocked and lorries constantly loading the steel to take to customers. This is the weighing scales, where the bars was weighed into bundles and labelled and logged for the customers. Dispatch office, where the orders are organised for loading onto the lorries. This is some of the lads who loaded the lorries: Robin Heseltine, Georgie Hancock, Mark Gayden and Wayne. A great bunch of lads. The only trouble was, most of the lads here and in the mill was Wolf supporters, and I was a West Bromwich Albion supporter. Some great banter between us over the years. Dougie Guest, the roll turner, asking me to take a set of rolls up to the mill as Dave Warrington comes out of the roll shop. That was Reg Gayden, a great mate of mine who owned his own haulage business and had a contract to deliver the steel, together with his sons Neil and Mark. This is Sam, driving number 2 crane, bringing a bundle of steel to load onto the British Steel lorry. Weight of each bundle was between 2.5 to 3 tonnes. from the mill is being diverted into the process bay, which allowed me to film these scenes from my crane. The cab of the crane and all the metal parts would get very hot, and the control levers were fitted with wooden handles to use. This is the back of the furnace, where the billets are brought in to be charged into the furnace. Billets are picked up using powerful magnets. Here is the billet yard, where I first started in 1975 as a loader on the floor loading the bogie trucks and unloading the delivery lorries. This is number 10 crane. That is number 9 crane. There was 2 battery powered trains used to shunt the trucks up and down the track. The billet yard is looking very depleted now, but in its heyday it would have stocked up to 20,000 tons of billets. Side now, and this is the crane I'm driving the mill. And This is the canteen. Mark Wilde slinging a bundle of steel. Together with Phil McCarr, they tie the bundle with a strong wire. Billy Steventon attaches a label to the other end. This is the roll changing crew, just starting to remove the old rolls to replace with new rolls to change the size or shape. Joe Bailey is to the left, and his brother David is on the right. Paul Elcock is wearing the orange top. This is Roy Good and Johnny Michael. This is during a downshift, when the mill isn't rolling.
That's off the scrapbook, look, eh? Dave, get up the crane.
Of course, I can't even see, really.
Hey, dip. That's more like it.
Really soon?
Wayne! We've got him on film up the crane, look! Never been known.
Obviously, I couldn't film myself up the crane, so I got one of my mates to film me. This is a great character wearing the blue hat talking to assistant rowler Davy Bailey. It's Steve Rowley, also known as Oddbod to everyone. It's 10 o'clock at night and the afternoon shift is clocking off. Les Till, Mark Prophet, Neil Bonner, Andy Metcalf and Ronnie Denson and Dave Gattenbury. Night shift and the cooling bed is beginning to fill up and the steel is being cut at the shears. This is Rainer, the quality control inspector, and Colin Jones, the shear operator. It's Rainer's job to take samples of the steel to test for their quality. Because the steel is still very hot, the bars are easily cut, but sometimes the bars were left to go cold, and there would be a loud bang as the bars were cut. You can see the bars being pushed across the transfer bay. Thank you. scale from the hook. Jackie Swift is driving the Process Bay crane, as Phil McCarr and Mark Wilde tie up the bundle of steel. Jimmy Russell removes the scrap back ends of steel from the cradle. Fitters changing the blades on the shears, usually at a different diameter bar to be cut. Audley Harvey is wearing the white hat, Freddie Woods the yellow hat, and Cliff the blue hat. This is a normal blade change, but sometimes the blades broke and had to be replaced. Outside in the billet yard, the lads are loading the trucks with steel, ready to go in the furnace. Chap wearing the check shirt is Joe Shirley, my old foreman when I worked in the billet yard. The chap in the Ivy's coat is Barry Spencer.
Sure,
Paul Cureton is driving the crane. It's my turn now to lift some steel from the mill.
Change it for 75. In the way.
Every bundle of steel is allocated to a numbered stock bed and logged into the computer. The steel can still be very hot, and the slingers have to be very careful. It's 6 o'clock in the morning, and the day shift is clocking on while the night shift is waiting to clock out. Ray McCall sits on his own at the table. As Jackie Eaton enters the canteen, and Georgie Hancox comes in and makes a pot of tea with Brian Cassidy.
And moved production to Yorkshire.
The night shift at British Steel's Cable Street Mill in Wolverhampton had been on a most important works outing. First stop was the House of Commons, where they met MPs to ask for help in saving their jobs.
There is jobs in the West Midlands, but they're very, very low-paid jobs. And we're talking about some men up there now with large mortgages and children at school and all the rest of it, you know. And not just going out to manage all the money that they get outside the plant.
British Steel want to close the plant next month at a cost of 135 jobs, moving production to Rotherham. Cable Street is the last British Steel production unit in the Black Country. The planned closure has provoked strong feelings.
I would sum it up as industrial vandalism. It's a perfectly good plant in a perfectly good location, making a perfectly good profit for the company.
From Westminster, the workers and their families crossed to British Steel's headquarters. The company's Director of Human Resources was on hand to receive the petition and a plea.
Please will you consider today the future of these young people. Give them some hope for the future.
Mr. Turner, I shall certainly ensure that the words you've sent to me there and the petition are given to the chairman.
Now the future of British Steel production in the Black Country rests in the hands of the company's board.
Protesters say plans to expand the region's largest shopping centre will
snuff their fight to save a steelworks in Wolverhampton with the loss of 135 jobs. Unions claim the Cable Street mill is profitable, but they've now accepted the redundancy terms on offer from British Steel.
Workers at the Cable Street mill in Wolverhampton are part of a tradition of metalworking on the site which dates back to 1850. The plant makes steel bars for industry, but British Steel is transferring production to more modern mills elsewhere in the country, and the plant will close next month.
It's another nail in the coffin for British industry here in the Midlands. Absolutely no reason whatsoever to close this plant down.
We're in the only employment black spot, obviously. What jobs are going around here are very, very poorly paid.
When you've got an accountant running manufacturing industry in this country, there's no future at all for the youngsters of the next generation.
But it's not all bad news for the Black Country's economy. Construction is now well underway on a new business park at Wensbury, itself built on the site of an old steelworks. The Black Country Development Corporation has already attracted American and Dutch light engineering companies to the site, creating several hundred new jobs.
When we came back from team work training, we worked better as a team. The product was a lot better, and having been with management and workers together at the Brookfield Manor, we all felt equal, and it's a shame that the Rowley Mill has got to close.
Go on, you're all right.
Derek Jones, the road trainer, also made a video before Cable Street Mill closed, and it can be seen later in the video working on the lathe.
To Cable Street, where we've been in for bloody 38 years or more. Occasionally, things went wrong, and this is what we called a cobble, which would happen unexpectedly. It was dragged off the mill as soon as possible and scrapped. Thank you. This is Derek, working in the roll turning shop, fitting bearings to the rolls, with the help of Dougie Guest.
Where all the billets come in, and then offloaded on the wagons, off the wagon trailer, and then dumped down, put onto the trains which are there. That's one of them, electric train. All going down the yard. The bottom end of the yard is empty, as you can see. And we'll see what.
These are mad electricians. Why, lads?
Ah, dear. Super duper. This is a locos. And a Billy Tom. I'll go all the way down the track. Into that hole there, where we're going in a minute. And this part of the billet yard is absolutely empty, as you can see. Sad, still. That's the way it goes. I'm just taking this for a bit of a memory for our Lou. And he used to work in what we call the glass house.
So we hop on the billet now. The language.
In the pulpit, operating the reversing rolls. Jackie Eaton in the middle pulpit. This is the vertical rolls. Steve Hughes, the roller, David Bailey, assistant roller, wearing the hat. This is Johnny Mycock. This is Roy Good. Jackie Swift, Process Bay crane driver. Jimmy Russell. Mark Boyle coming down the steps and Billy Stevenson slinging. Kim Shelton with Dougie Guest. Tommy Ben.
All the process by. Did it all happen well? It's all stopped. Ready to go out. The railer, another railer. All the show there.
Ian Bonner working on the railer.
Time to come up.
engine has come back now. One of the furnaces. There's Bushy over there. Balls upon it. He's Oddy the main man. Can't get Willie's features, you see, he keeps on turning round the other way. This is the man what was in the toilets, ladies and gentlemen. But the what it work. The light on it, Dave. Looking at her.
So this is Roddy and this is the Mrs. Ben.
The big fat. it's all being recorded now.
We've got to go on record the second.
Of course it does. Oh, well, we got to... Look at this, yeah. It's recorded,
yeah,
right? Now let it off, just let it off, it'll keep recording, press it.
Alright.
Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know where, it looks very dark. Mm-hmm.
lot better now.
Yeah, well, if you go up, it takes another light. Just knock it
off. Yeah, it's a mixer of that. I
understand that, so it's just... yeah, it's...
It's just like around there, just
right. Yeah. So all those things are getting zoom in and everything, so...
Hello! Time sit as well, aren't you, sir? I said I can swear in.
I don't swear anymore, do I? Derek, you turn it off, please.
This is the little girl who runs around with a white hat on.
I say, what the hell was that making there?
Go back a bit, I'll go get all your legs in. Oh, shit.
You got that one in, oh, shit.
Great women.
Where? Yeah, well, you got seams in your stockings, have you? Well, this is it. This is the mill. On what we call a downshift. As quiet as a graveyard. Or with a little bit of heat treatment over the back. And beforehand, like an inferno. There's all the other stands. All the stuff on the finishing stands rather, and it goes all the way down there, as you've seen on the other shop. Believe it or not, this is what we used to call the blacksmith's shop. Doing a bit of toast up there, look, holy ghost. Well, there won't be much on it left, Keith, will there? Well, this is the way it goes, Keith, eh? Nothing we can do. There's the old anvil there, look. There's the old bumper loop.